Okay, great. Thank you.
Recording in progress.
Dear doctors and friends, good evening. I welcome you all to this CME on joint health, financial health, and legal health from my center, Southeast Specialty Orthopedic Center, SSOC, Bangalore, India. The faculty today are myself and Mr. Subhav. He's a senior partner of Wealthy.in company. And we got a very senior advocate, Dr. Arun Mishra, senior advocate of High Court and Supreme Court of India. And he'll be joining us soon in another half an hour's time from Mumbai. So I welcome you to this first three-in-one kind of meeting. This is the first hybrid meeting that my center is organizing after the pandemic way back in November 2019. And here we had Dr. Manoj Pujari. He was an anesthetic consultant from Harley Street Hospital, London. Harley Street, as many of you know, is one of the top private clinics and hospitals in the world and gets mentioned even in a book like Sherlock Holmes, you know, a detective series that everybody knows really. At the outset, I would like to thank all the faculties who have spared their valuable time to educate us. I thank all the delegates who have spared their valuable time and come here physically and online. Thanks to all the sponsors who are standing shoulder to shoulder with my center in these difficult times. Special thanks to my friend, Dr. Ashok Shyam from Ortho TV, who is broadcasting it through Ortho TV to the whole of India and to orthopedic surgeons. Thank you, Dr. Ashok. And last but not the least, thanks to my team for being part of this unique, thought-provoking webinar. This is the program details for today. We kickstart after the welcome with a talk from myself on the latest advances in arthritis and its management. JRFT stands for Get It Right First Time. Where are we in 2021? And this will be followed by a brief question and answers. There'll be plenty of time. Please keep your questions to the end of this webinar. And this will be followed by Mr. Subhav, who's going to talk on tips and tricks to grow your money. What's the investment which beats your tax slab and your real inflation? As you all know, India has having a bull run in stock markets and the Sensex has hit 60,000 for the first time. So today is Subhav's birthday as well. So he's a very happy man today. So you're going to really hear how to grow money further. And we'll have a brief question answers at the end of that. And at around 8 o'clock, Dr. Arun Mishra, the senior advocate, Honorable Supreme Court will join us. And he's going to address us about what is an ideal medical indemnity for doctors in India in 2021. This will be followed by question and answers. And then we close it at around 8:30, 8:45 after the Q&A session with a vote of thanks. As the introduction to the guest, Mr. Subhav, he's an MBA in finance. He's a senior partner at Wealthy.in. And he's a senior wealth management consultant with the experience of 17 years. He manages an AUM of around 100 crores. He has worked with leading banks like Deutsche Bank, ABN AMRO, ICICI in wealth management. He's a specialist in mutual funds, PMS, alternate investment plans, insurance plans, loans. We are all very keen on COVID loans to save people's lives in India. We want to hear about that from Mr. Subhav, and unlisted shares and SME. He believes in long-term relation building with all the clients. Our second speaker, our last but not the least speaker, doesn't need any introduction. He's advocate Dr. Arun Mishra. He is a PhD, MD, LLM, double degree holder, D-Pharm, D-Yoga, advanced PG in mysticism and PG in mythology, DMLT. He is practicing advocate of the Honorable High Court and Supreme Court of India. He is a medico-legal consultant, criminal and corporate lawyer. He provides doctor's risk medico-legal service. He is a LLM crime from Mumbai University. He has 3 degrees in medicine, microbiology and law. And he has 3 postgraduate degrees in medicine, yoga and law. An incredible array of achievements, really. And one of the best medico-legal consultants in India with success rate close to 100%. He has handled more than 16,000 medico-legal cases in the last 16 years in India with use of the latest medical legal laws, High Court and Supreme Court judgments. As you know, like medicine court, you know, law also evolves, and you need to quote the latest judgments to win over the judges rather than giving a, you know, quotation from 100 years ago. He has authored a book called Law of Medicine, which runs into 8 volumes. His aim is to build awareness and, most importantly, unity and confidence among doctors through his Voice of Doctors approach to bring medical fraternity together. I was speaking to Professor Nandimat, the professor of law at National School of Law in Bangalore recently, and he told that, you know, as a professor of law, as a lawyer, you know, he really doesn't understand where the shoe pinches for the doctor. So when they are in the court defending a doctor, they really don't understand what is the problem that the doctor is undergoing. And I think Dr. Advocate, you know, Dr. Arun Mishra, who is a doctor come advocate, is the best solution to the problems that the doctors face in India today. So sir is joining in a short while. We will welcome him. And, you know, without wasting much time, I think I will sort of kickstart with my first presentation of the day. So I'll just move on from this to my other presentation. Dr. Ashok, can you see this slides, modern concepts? Dr. Ashok? Srikant, can you give me a thumbs up on chat to say that you can see the slides? Need some feedback? Great, so we'll start on now. Okay, dear doctors and friends, I welcome you all this evening to this talk on modern concepts in management of knee and hip arthritis. GIRFT, that is Get It Right First Time, where are we in 2021? For those who do not know me, I'm Dr. Srikant KM. I'm consultant knee and hip surgeon. These are my qualifications. Particularly proud to have worked in Wrightington Hospital, the birthplace of joint replacement surgery in the world. I was formerly a consultant in trauma and joint replacement surgery in the UK. At present, I'm proprietor and managing director of Sarathi Specialty Knee and Hip Center in Gavipuram, Bangalore, and also attached to Court of Corporate Hospitals in South Bangalore and to Shankar Group of Hospitals in Bangalore. Again, I would like to welcome all the delegates who are both offline and online today. And I trained in UK in all aspects of orthopedics and trauma. I've got special interest in computer-assisted robotic knee hip surgery, patient-specific implants, for which I did a GMC recognized fellowship at Plymouth Teaching Hospital. I have a specialist interest in hip and knee sports and revision surgery, for which I did a fellowship in A1 Orthopedic Center, Bristol. The A1 Orthopedic Center is famous for the A1 knee. And the third fellowship was a septic revision fellowship at Endoclinic in Hamburg, Germany with Prof. Gurka. And I provide quaternary referral service in India for these difficult infected revision cases. I'm proud to have done my UG and PG from the prestigious Bangalore Medical College and Research Center, Bangalore. I was a National Merit Scholar throughout. I bring experience of more than 15,000 joint replacements over 14 years in the UK. I'm very fortunate to have worked in 4 out of the 5 specialist orthopedics unit in the UK, which are known as centers of excellence, where the infection rate is less than 1%. Which is lowest in the world. I'm also a director of Meet the Masters course, a course which we run every October. And we are coming to the 4th course end of October. And here we push boundaries in orthoplasty and in our understanding of orthoplasty. My objective is to provide affordable but high quality knee hip replacement and revision service in Bangalore, Karnataka, and India. This was last Meet the Masters course in 2020. Here you can see the picture of Professor Alistair Hart. He's very well-known orthopedic professor from University College London. And in fact, the BBC has called him as the hospital hip detective. He's got his left hand over my left shoulder there. And he gave an amazing talk in the last Meet the Masters course on 3D printing in orthopedics. And we had a very exciting debate on the future of orthopedic surgery with him and my mentor, Dr. Everett Smith. And it was an unbelievable webinar. And also, I'm flanked by Professor John Skinner, who is the immediate past president of the British Orthopedic Association on my left side. The experience related to this topic, I trained in UK in all aspects of orthopedics and trauma, a specialist interest in computer-assisted robotic knee hip surgery, patient-specific implant, for which I did a fellowship in Plymouth Teaching Hospitals nearly a decade ago. This is the presentation of the fellowship by Dr. Jonathan Keenan, Director of Orthoplasty at Plymouth Teaching Hospitals. This is the certificate of fellowship from the GMC. This is in recognition of my excellence in knee replacement surgery. I was in fact nicknamed Sri the Knee. This is done by my boss's daughter, you know, with a cricket bat on the right side because of my passion for cricket, and a revision knee implant on the left side because of my passion for revision knees. This is my second fellowship with Dr. Everett Smith. He's a UK head of European Hip Society and the director of the world famous Bristol Hip Arthroplasty course. I'm again very happy to announce that in November end, we'll be bringing this live to India and Southeast Asia. And also I worked with Mr. Anthony Ward, the director of pelvic vestibular surgery for Southwest of the UK. This is Dr. Everett Smith and myself in the first doing a first spare approach, which is a minimally invasive hip approach in India at the All India Institute of Medical Science on the left side. And I'll tell you a little story. You know, this patient was a very young patient, 28-year-old with dysplastic hip. And, you know, I and Everett went to see her in Ames. And I thought he's going to make her lie down on the couch and examine the hip and check the fixed flexion deformity, range of movement, etc. But he didn't do anything. He just looked at her spine and checked her spine. Then he looked at her x-ray. Then she said, is it okay if he operates on her? These are the only three questions he asked. And this is unbelievable because I will deal with it why he asked that at the later part of the presentation, why this is very crucial. On the right-hand side picture, inaugural Meet the Masters course at Lee Meridian Hotel, where Dr. Everett Smith is there, and I'm flagged by my teachers, Professor J.K. Reddy and Professor Pushottam, and my friend Dr. Amarnath. This is my third fellowship at Endoclinic with Prof. Gurkha. He's a well-known authority on septic revision. And he's one of the few gurus of single-stage septic revision surgery where you take the implant out and then put a new implant in the same setting. And these are complex surgeries lasting for 3 to 5 hours. Very proud to have worked with Dr. Richard Parkinson, my mentor. And he was a past president of the British Knee Society from 2014 to 2016. He was voted the top 10 best knee replacement surgeons and teachers in UK. He inspired me way back in 1999, 2000 to become a knee surgeon, actually. Coming to today's subject, we've got a diverse group of people joining online and offline. So I keep it a little basic. Apologies to the senior orthopedic surgeons in the group. So arthritis, it affects knee and hip arthritis, affects around 20 million people in India, almost 1 in 5 people. Around 25% of them will need surgical intervention at some point in their lifetime. COVID has proved one thing, that there's a big doctor shortage in India. And, before the pandemic, people used to say there are too many doctors, but that was proved completely wrong by the pandemic. Hence, there is a big skill shortage. And hence, every trained and untrained surgeon is at hip and knee replacement. In a robotic and computer-assisted surgery, there's a saying that garbage in is garbage out. If the feeding is bad for the computer, then the outcome is going to be a little poorer. There's a basic tenet in arthroplasty, the rule that if you fail to prepare, you prepare to fail during surgery. This is the outcome of an untrained person at arthroplasty. Who really wants this outcome? This is an immediate post-op, a hip with a central fracture dislocation. We now know that in India, we have the Draconian Consumer Protection Act 2019. I was with Professor Nandimath and went through a few weeks ago all the 20 slides of the Consumer Protection Act 2019. And I can't say everything, but one thing I understood as a synopsis from the CPA 2019 is that earn in thousands but lose in crores. You know, that's what CPA 2019 stands for. Coming to the knee arthritis, knee is a complex three-dimensional hinge. You know, the basic question we ask is what is causing the knee pain? How old is the patient? Was there a traumatic event? Is the pain, where is the site of the pain? Did the symptoms develop immediately or over time? Once these questions are answered, we can put symptoms with signs together to arrive at a diagnosis. The basic take-home steps for knee arthritis is that pain while walking downstairs is typically due to kneecap problems like chondromalacia, softening of patella. Morning pain and stiffness is get better with the activity is typical of early arthritis. A sharp pain with clicking, locking of the knee is commonly due to meniscal pathology, patellofemoral problems, or loose fragments in the knee. A pop associated with sudden swelling of the knee and giving way, particularly in the young patient, is due to cruciate ligament injury. Arthritis of the knee, any type of inflammatory arthropathy like rheumatoid arthritis can develop as an isolated monoarthritis of the knee. These are the standard investigations we do in a knee arthritis. The treatment options and principles. If there's isolated knee arthritis, if infection is ruled out, one can inject the knee with intra-articular corticosteroids. Platelet-rich plasma with PRP is coming back in a big way in the last 7 years. Artificial synovial fluid like Synvisc is also used quite commonly. Stem cells are making a comeback in the last 2 years quite strongly. And this can be repeated a few times in a year. The treatment for OA of the knee is similar to that of a hip. With, you know, you can use physiotherapy to help, you know, control it. So newer approved offloader knee brace and insoles can also be very useful. There are many types of non-replacement surgeries. You know, like diagnostic arthroscopy, where you put a scope in the knee and have a look and see what is going on. And if there is a meniscal problem, you can trim the meniscus or you can repair the meniscus. And then there is an arthroscopic microfracture where you put a scope and see if there's a loss of cartilage in the femur or tibia. You can drill multiple holes which fill up with fibrocartilage. Or Oates grafting, where there is a complete loss of cartilage, grade 4 as we say, then we take cartilage from the non-weight bearing area and put them like cigarette packs in the weight-bearing area. And also, one can take cartilage from the non-weight-bearing area, grow it in a petri dish in the lab, and bring it back, and then you can put it back in what is called as artificial cartilage implantation, ACR-MACI procedures. And then if there is a damage to ligaments like ACL, PCL, or posterolateral corner, you can replace them, you know, replace these damaged ligaments. Indications for knee replacement surgery, mainly in osteoarthrosis, it is 96%, you know. Second is inflammatory arthropathy, around 3%, and post-traumatic arthritis, less than 1%. Average age is around 67, slightly more female preponderance. So there are many types of knee replacement surgery. You know, you don't need to do a full replacement all the time. So there are three compartments in the knee. And if only one compartment is damaged, you can replace that, what is called as a partial knee replacement. Either we can do medial, lateral, or a patellofemoral joint replacement. It has become very popular in the last 5 years in India, but we've been doing it for 15, 20 years in the UK. And even osteotomy is making a big comeback in the last couple of years, you know, partly due to the push from the companies. Coming to when all the compartments are damaged, we have to do a total knee replacement. And what is new about a total knee replacement? It's computer navigated, robotic, or 3D augmented surgery. So what does it really do? You know, in 2021, there's still debate going on between alignment, like, you know, what is the right alignment versus balance in the knee? You know, whether whereas the balance of the knee is more important or the alignment is more important. And still, this is an unresolved conundrum. And, you know, these modern technologies help predictable accuracy, make surgery safe for the patient and recordable. And recordable means the data, you know, can be saved. And data is the new gold, as they say. During my fellowship, I did around 600 navigation. There's a huge amount of data, and that data can be used for future of how we have to go in the next 5 to 10 years, really. And thus, it prepares better surgeons of tomorrow, leads to transparency and future learning, as I mentioned, and some degree of accountability as well. And these technologies act like a patient-specific implant because we now know that all knees are not the same. This is a knee replacement picture of it. Basically, it's a neuropathic spacer to relieve pain from an arthritic joint. This is some of the post-op x-rays from one of the robotic knee surgeries that I was involved in. When I moved to India a few years ago, there are many common myths that I had to encounter. One was that eyeballing was better than computer navigation or robotics. Now I think this debate is settled. Even our own children will say that computers are more accurate and robot is definitely accurate. So I don't need to prove this anymore. And one size fits all, you know. You know, we can't put size 8 shoes or chappals for everybody in India. The truth is every knee is unique. Every human being is unique. And looking at an X-ray and doing a total knee replacement means only giving a three-dimensional solution to a knee, which is exactly a three-dimensional problem. And the other myth is that you can always plan surgery on the table. So not a good idea. And I am the robot. I think this thing I discussed in last Meet the Masters program at length. So I'll not go into details. The second myth that I faced is that, anybody can do a knee or hip replacement in India. So what's so big about it? And I did a UK trainee survey during my time in UK, and my registrars, my trainees also thought the same thing. They said, what's there? You know, Mr. Srikanth, knee replacement is very easy. Just open the knee, put the jig, you know, cut the bone, bang the implant and close it up. So big deal. So when I moved to India, you know, I had to meet several corporate CEOs in the first couple of years. And they also said the same thing. Well, anybody can do knee and hip replacement. And I really didn't understand what was going on here. And it took a couple of years for me to understand that they are coming from this concept called EBDTA, that is earning before deduction of tax and other expenses. In simple terms, it means pay less and earn more. Who would not want to do that? So, but the Honorable Supreme Court has recently come back and they've said that the pay for the Ayush doctors should be same as MBBS doctors if they're doing the same job. So there's equality in pay, and it can destroy this EBDTA concept. So they need to come up with some clever ideas to go around this really. This is Dr. John Insall, father of knee replacement surgery at Hospital for Specialist Surgery. And what did he say about knee replacement? He said knee replacement is a soft tissue operation with some bony cuts. He didn't say it was a bony operation. So why did he say so? You know, that too, he said this in the 1970s. And, you know, in 2021, that is this year, we are fully realizing the value of what he said, you know, in 1970s. So that means the great masters can predict what the future is going to be. And this year, we are debating, you know, is balance, you know, does balance in the knee trumps alignments? You know, is soft tissue is more important than the bone? And this, he said, in 1970s. So in 2021, the challenges we face as surgeons is, what is the alignment we need to have? Is it anatomical, like God-given, or should be mechanical, you know, which is good for the processes, or should it be based on function called kinematic or functional, or should it be adjusted anatomic or adjusted kinematic? And there are proponents for each of these theories, and, you know, there are people who completely believe that that's the right way to do a knee replacement surgery. So why did Dr. John Insall say that knee replacement is a soft tissue operation? Because he understood the role of ligaments in the knee. If you look at anterior translation of tibia on the femur, you know, it is prevented by the anterior cruciate ligament, but it's also prevented by the medial and lateral collateral ligament. If you look at the posterior translation of the tibia and the femur, you know, it is prevented by the posterior cruciate ligament, but also by the MCL. Internal rotation is resisted by the ACL, but also by posteromedial complex. External rotation at 30 degrees, as you know, is resisted by the posterolateral complex, and at 90 degrees by the PCL, but at all angles by MCL. So whereas valgus is resisted by ACL secondarily, but primarily at 30 degrees knee flexion by MCL and HCL respectively. So you can see that each ligament is doing multiple jobs really. So the knee is called a complex three-dimensional hinge because it's got 6 degrees of freedom. You know, in flexion, it can move from side to side. In extension, it can rotate. In extension, it can compress and distract. In flexion, it can, you know, again rotate in that particular plane, or it can roll back like a ball along a slide, or it can move along an axis called as a transepicondylar axis, like a door hinge. So if you look at these 6 degrees of freedom of the knee and combine it with the basic three cuts that we have to do a knee replacement, basically tibia, femur, and the patella, yeah, even as most experienced orthopedic surgeon can get a knee replacement wrong in 215 different ways. So I have answered the, you know, given answer to the myths in India. If anybody could do a knee and hip replacement, you can see the picture on the left-hand side. This is not a pandemic time. This is not an N95 mask. You can imagine what it is. It was 2015 slide. And, you know, a clear no if you have patients' interest at your heart. It's called the basic, you know, ethical principle is primum non sere. That means first do no harm. So in UK, they used to say, if in doubt, ask. You know, there's no shame in asking. You know, I don't enjoy spinal surgeries. If there is a spinal surgery, I usually get a spinal surgeon or a neurosurgeon. We do the operation together. There's no shame in that, really. So a proper training and experience is a must for these procedures. And hence these modern concepts of navigation, PSI, 3D augmented surgery and robotics of kind. You know this guy, why he's best in the world? Because you can measure what he has done. You know, Usain Bolt, and still his record remains unbroken. There are a number of limitations of the human eye. Eyeballing can't differentiate less than 10 degrees of change in angulation. We know that more than 6 degrees of change in varus valgus alignment of the knee leads to catastrophic failure of the total joint replacement. You don't want a bad day at office to affect the outcome of your patient's surgery. You want to minimize surgeon error when so many factors are at play, some known and many unknown, like the role of ligaments. And 1 millimeter accuracy, as we know, is humanly impossible. And, you know, alignment, we discussed about the types of alignment versus balance issue is not still fully resolved in 2021. So there's a need for, you know, patient-specific or computer-assisted or robotic 3D augmented surgery. There are many varieties of it. Many of you know, so I don't want to bore you with that. But most importantly, we need to know why change. Why do we change? We change because, you know, historically we thought that the knee, you know, opened like a 2D hinge, like a door hinge. But we now know that the door hinge not only opens, but also rotates. Imagine your door rotating rather than just opening and closing. You can think how complex the joint is. Then we move to the J-shaped J-curve kinematics. And then we move to the transepicondylar axis as a place where the rotation occurs. But in the last 4 or 5 years, the work done by Ekoff shows that there is a transcylindrical axis through which the knee actually moves. You can see the lines here. The yellow line is the epicondylar axis, and the green is a transcylindrical axis. And, you know, the 20% of dissatisfaction following knee replacement surgery is ascribed to not putting the implant parallel to the transcylindrical axis. So what is shape matching? You know, basically we produce two models, arthritic model and the planning model. So where there is, you modulate how the knee would look before the arthritis set in. Then we produce this custom-made cutting guides, which are machined, considering all the 6 degrees of freedom that I mentioned earlier. And we use the machine, the guides to do the surgery. So what is, you know, the basic principle of PSI robotics, CAS or 3D augmented knee surgery, all same. The surgeon basically gets an advanced investigation pre-op through CT, MRI or perioperatively by, you know, doing a 3D mapping of the knee. Then, you know, that's sent to for planning, and they either produce a jig or, you know, there is a virtual operation which is done by the robot there. You know, you do a surgery before surgery basically, and then look at the alignment and the soft tissue balance, and then finally the jigs are produced to do the cut, or the robot does the cutting bit, taking all the 6 degrees of freedom into account. I started robotics in Bangalore since this year. It has the same principles. It really gives 1 millimeter accuracy. The bone cut is done taking all the 6 degrees of freedom into account. Every time I'm surprised that always there's a less soft tissue dissection compared to what I was doing before, and there's less blood loss, and my incidence of blood transfusion has come down. This is the graph from the first surgery that I did, and this patient had early rehabilitation and a straight leg raise at immediate and early discharge as well. Dr. Kaper was the inventor of this system, and you could see the flat line there on the bottom where the orange lines and the blue line show that the knee is perfectly balanced in flexion extension from 0 to 130 degrees, and there's not even 1 millimeter opening. And I'm sure Dr. Kaper would be proud of this graph really. And, you know, this is the first time, you know, that we are able to really have an objective measure of the, you know, varus valgus balance, you know, in the knee from throughout the range of movement. And I don't think we ever had an objective proof. People always would say, oh, my knee is better balanced than your knee or vice versa. But now we have proof that, yes, this knee is really balanced. And hence, this is going to be the future. This is one of the post-op x-rays done using similar kind of technology. This is the first patient robotic, immediate post-surgery. She was able to straight leg rise after surgery. And also she's able to bend the knee to around 80 degrees, following the procedure. So, which was quite incredible, very less soft tissue dissection, no blood transfusion for this lady. So as I say, the future is now. So the future is patient-specific implants, computer-assisted 3D augmented robotic surgery. Many advantages are there: enhanced accuracy, reduced bleeding and maybe tray time, and reduce cost of revision burden actually, and minimally invasive surgery is possible. And these knees are very close to the patient-specific implants, and less soft tissue dissection, less pain, blood loss, and faster rehabilitation, and better function, and we can reach our holy grail of knee replacement, which is a forgotten knee where you don't feel the implant. And the soft tissue algorithm, I think that's going to come next in the next 5-10 years. So we will move on to some of the, you know, experience, my own experience here in India after I moved back. So proof of the pudding, the Indian experience. This is a computer-assisted surgery of a lady who had a bariatric surgery to reduce her weight. This was done in a hospital which was opened just 2 weeks ago, a small hospital in a place called Banashankari. And so, you know, it can be done in a smaller setup as well. And this is a day one post-op where she's able to have a, you know, complete straightening and a flexion up to 90 degrees. This is another lady post-op where she's able to, you know, lift the leg straight up after surgery in the recovery and also bend the knee. And this is not only because of medical surgery, but also because of good anesthetists. And we should never forget our colleagues and their real help to us, really. Coming to more complex cases, differentiating men from the boys, you know, this lady was a 60-year-old, 120-kg diabetic. She was operated by the top two arthroplasty surgeon of Karnataka, our state. Unfortunately, the knee got infected. The surgeon tried and he did five more surgeries to resolve this, but he was not able to resolve this. And he left her with no joint and she was in a bedridden state. So it was 2 years after the last surgery that her daughter came to me and said, "Dr. Srikanth, can you help me?" She had a disabled sister whom she was looking after and a disabled mother. And it was getting too much for her to look after two disabled people. And I said, why not? This is my training in Germany and in the UK. Let's see what could be done. This is the knee she had on the left-hand side. And on the right-hand side, this is how she came to me without an implant. The issues that she had was obesity. She was diabetic. She had five failed surgeries before. She had multiple scars. You can see that I'm marking all the scars with the blue pen there. And in the last surgery, the primary surgeon was not able to close the wound. So he had asked for help and got his plastic surgeon to come and bail him out. And they have done a gastrocnemius flap, one of the head they had used. So I knew that if I get into trouble with this surgery, I'll have only one head of gastrocnemius left to bail me out, actually. And she had marked shortening of around an inch. And you can see that I'm measuring there in the bottom, the limb length discrepancy of an inch. And she needed a bariatric table and she needed a bold anesthetist to take her on. So we planned aspirated knee and we grew E. coli and we got antibiogram. I planned the revision in two stages. So, you know, we put antibiotic loaded spacer there with a proper antibiotic as per the antibiogram. ESR and CRP came back to normal in around 8 weeks time. So further aspiration and culture came back negative for any growth. And the second stage issues were which hospital to choose. And it was a teamwork. It was a combined plastic ortho teamwork and had to get clearance from a senior physician, nephrologist, cardiologist, vascular surgeon, and a senior anesthetist to go ahead with surgery. The challenges during second stage was the type of anesthesia. It was a prolonged surgery lasting 4.5 to 5 hours. And, you know, one can run out of steam doing these prolonged surgeries. We know typically after 2.5-3 hours, we get very tired after surgery. And if you are not trained in these complex surgeries, you can run out of steam and want to close the wound and come out. So, you know, and she had a massive fluid shift because of the duration of surgery. And quite rightly, she was in ICU for 24 hours. And as promised to me, the anesthetist got her out of the ICU back into the ward in 24 hours. She had issues with quadriceps, which was also dealt with during the time of surgery. And after many more challenges, I could put this implant on the right-hand side. And, you know, after 2.5 years of being bedridden, she was able to walk for the first time. People say doctors operate for money, but, you know, this is what gives me more happiness and satisfaction than the money the patient is able to pay me. Coming to the second example of a complex case, this was a 50-year-old female. She had not walked for 2 years again. She was literally carried by her son to my center. I remember her being carried in the hand. It reminded me of the old Sanat Kumar in our mythology where he used to carry elderly parents you know, for pilgrimage. And she was seen by a very respected professor of orthopedic surgery. He was professor to my professor, Professor Iyer. He is well-known and incidentally happens to be the father-in-law of IOA, Indian Orthopedic Association president, and he had said this is a very complex case and God help you. And knee was aspirated by one of my colleagues and he had grown nothing. So she basically came to me with a fixed flexion deformity of 90. That is, the knee was stuck at 90 degrees and not moving. So I got an MR scan, which showed a complete destruction of the joint and pus in the knee, hip and ankle. So I had to plan, you know, in a stage revision for her. I opened up the knee, found a frank pus in the knee. So I did a radical debridement. I sent the samples for every test in the country. And I put an antibiotic loaded cement spacer. And I've done every investigation. All the investigations came negative. I was in a quandary. Fortunately, because of my training, I was always taught to send samples for histology. I had sent it to Rangadurai Hospital to my friend, Dr. Prasad. He called me yesterday. He said, Shrikant, this is classic caseating granuloma tuberculosis. So he bailed me out, really. And, I started on ATT. And the issues with her was she had paper-thin quality of the bone, and their economic status was poor. And they said, Dr. Shrikant, if you put a revision knee implant for 2.5 lakhs, if it gets infected again, we really don't have money to do anything. So, and even fusion nails at that time were 1.5 to 2 lakhs. Even now it's the same. So they opted for fusion. So I had to think about Jugaad and, get a customized nail done from Ahmedabad, which would fit her. And with the HET and the fusion, nail, she went on to fusion in around 6 months' time. So coming to hip, briefly, I'll touch upon the painful hip condition, role of hip arthroscopy in delaying total hip replacement, patient-specific and custom-made total hip replacement, and the latest controversy or the hot topic in hip, which is the spine-pelvic hip axis. Where does the hip pain go? It can go to either groin, or it can go to deep groin, or to lateral side, what we call trochanter, it can cause back pain, or it can go to knee. Many patients come with knee pain, but they have the hip problem. The basic investigations we do are x-rays, and nowadays we are doing sitting and standing spine x-rays of the hip. We do MRI or MR arthrography, and a 3D CT can be done for the trauma conditions. And hip block is a very common procedure that I do quite a lot. And treatment is same as knee OA, rest, avoid the posture leading to pain. Go through the analgesic ladder as per the WHO, and encourage patient to lose weight. Physiotherapy is very important, and you can do ultrasound or X-ray guided steroid injection into the knee, into the hip. So hip arthroscopy, which is a keyhole procedure, is becoming quite important. You can go inside and see any soft tissue injury, and if there is a damage to the labrum, acetabular labrum or lip, you can either trim it or repair it and delay arthritis. Hip replacement, last but not the least, we're going to touch upon where are we in 2021. So this is the latest controversy is happening, spine, pelvis, and hip axis. It's the hottest topic in joint arthroplasty now. So this is a picture, an x-ray. You can see it was a hip done in UK, not from India. It was not done long time ago, around 6 months ago. You can see on the left-hand side a perfectly done total hip replacement, okay? And you can see in the middle picture that a perfectly done total hip replacement has dislocated. And the patient had a revision where the surgeon has put a different stem, and he had to put a collared neck, the head to really increase the offset and make the whole thing stable. And, it's unbelievable why he did a perfectly looking hip replacement dislocated. And this happened because the surgeon failed to examine that the patient had a stiff spine. I mentioned about Mr. Edward Smith. When we saw the patient in Ames, the first thing he did around 4 years ago was he examined the spine, not the hip or the FFT. So we now know that if there's a stiff spine, even if you get the hip replacement spot on, the hip will dislocate. So I was in a meeting with Professor Ed Davies. He's a professor of robotics in Royal Orthopedic Hospital, Birmingham. When I worked, he was my consultant. I asked recently, around 8 weeks ago, Ed, what is the solution for this? How can you demystify the spine pelvic hip axis? And he said, Sri, this is a very complex area, and I can't at this time really. So when they can't do it, so can an untrained really do it? That's a question really. So this is another example. Simple is not easy. Easy is not always good. This is again a surgery done in the UK, not in India. And it looks good. It looks okay. But the patient successfully sued the surgeon for a limb length discrepancy. You can see on the left-hand side, what did the surgeon miss? There was a varus neck. So, the neck shaft angle on the left was not typical 127 degrees, but around 120 or 122. And he used what's the implant, which is very popular in India, the uncemented implant. And the uncemented implant, you can't reproduce anatomy. It goes where it wants to go. It is quick, easy to do, more money for the company, but it may not be the best for the patient. And, as I mentioned, earning lakhs and losing crores is the dictum of the new CPA 2019. So, what is the solution for this? I think the solution is a cemented hip, which is sadly going out of fashion in India, which is unfortunate. And our OPS, I'm going to discuss about OPS in the Meet the Masters course next month. Robotics like Cori is coming back in a big way, or custom hip. This is one of the custom hip called a Symbios hip. It's an exact fit anatomic THR. It leads to better functional results and a longer shelf life of the implant. Many surgeons, both juniors and seniors, ask me, sir, you know, I want to work in the UK. Please help me get a job there. And, you know, I oblige, and I'm very proud to say that my last three fellows are in the UK right now, and each of them are earning now around 36 lakhs rupees per year. I'm very proud of that. And, you know, the UK, what are they looking at for surgeons? They're looking at three things: knowledge, skill, and attitude. Okay. So let's go through this example. So this was a surgery done not far from my center. You know, a senior surgeon did a knee replacement. And left-hand side, unfortunately for him, the knee replacement got infected. And when it got infected, you know, a few weeks later, he was forced and he did a revision. And this was a revision implant which was done. The skill, you know, has done a great job. It looks very good. And, you know, while putting the stems there, you know, what he did is he chose to put cement around the stem. Unfortunately for him, this knee also got infected around 6 weeks later. Then he is in a dilemma. What do you do now? And because he has put the cement around the stems, it was extremely difficult for him to take it out. So he had to shatter the femur and tibia, split it, and take it out, as you see in the middle picture. And once that is done, you are sort of condemning the patient to knee fusion. You can't do anything else, while you could have really saved the movement of the knee. So he was in a meeting, an All India meeting, and I asked him what was the reason for cementing. And usually in this meeting, many top guys from the world are always there. And, you know, when I asked, you know, Professor Amar Ranawat from Hospital for Specialist Surgery, New York, said, yes, I agree. Why was the stem cemented? So I think, you know, our work is being watched not by people in India, but abroad as well. So we need to be really good at it. And, you know, that we can have two types of attitude. We could say, okay, I learned from a mistake, I correct. That's a great attitude. Or we could say, who is this guy to tell me, you know, and then we stay where we are. I criticize every one of my own x-rays, including the robotic x-rays, so that I can perform better surgery next time. So as Dr. Alexander Artemyev has said, there are four phases a surgeon goes through when faced with difficulty or hemorrhage. One is, why did I get involved with this difficult surgery? The next phase is, why did I become a surgeon? Then third phase is, why did I become a doctor? The fourth phase is, why was I born? So I think my take-home messages is, get it right first time is an important evolving concept in arthroplasty. The insurers, the patients, and the legal fraternity will demand this more from us in future. Revision knee hip surgery is a complex area of work, can take from 2 hours to 6 hours. It needs a lot of patience, resilience, passion, teamwork, and experience to do this. And as I said, one can run out of steam after 2 to 3 hours of surgery and you feel like closing the wound and coming out of theater. So training is a must to perform these complex work to acceptable standards. Mr. Steve Beverland, the biggest arthroplasty surgeon in the UK, who described transverse acetabular ligament, you know, the ligament what all the hip surgeons in the world use to put our acetabular cuff. He only does primary hip replacement surgery, refers all revisions, because he's not trained to do revision surgery. There's absolutely no shame. If a big surgeon like him, world authority, is referring, you know, there's no shame. You know, I mentioned about spines. I normally do combined work with spinal surgeons or with neurosurgeons. There's no shame. You put patient safety before, you know, your own pride. And in UK, all infected revisions are referred by revision surgeons to consultants with special interest in infected revision. And there's no role for being a macho and, you know, saying, oh, I can do everything from head to toe. So life is short. COVID has drilled that into us in the last 1 to 2 years. Why take needless risk? Always we have to calculate the risk versus benefit. You know, combined work is the order of the day and the need. And I would tell all the younger surgeons that don't perform, you know, complex surgeries by looking at YouTube or UMIDI videos, which is quite popular. The CPA 2019 is very hostile to the doctors. And I wish the doctors were not part of it and will come out of it soon. When things go wrong, you know, we will get roasted, you know, like Dr. Alexander Artemyev said. But in India, you also get jousted and unfortunately get attacked by the patient's relative, which is really unfortunate. The popular saying in the UK, when in doubt, refer to appropriate trained specialists or opt for combined work. In conclusion, SSOC offers top-of-the-line treatment in joint replacement surgery for knee, hip, and revision surgery. Patient safety is at the heart of the care. Team trained by European Hip Society President and British Knee Society President. Let's work together, friends, for safer surgery for our patients and less stress and hassles for ourselves. I thank you very much for the patient listening. These are the references for my talk, and this is how to contact me. And I really seek your support to serve these patients better. So I thank you very much for the patient listening. If there is any questions, you know, we will take it for 5 minutes as we are running late already. If not, we will go to the next topic. Dr. Ashok, are there any questions in the chat box in Ortho TV? Any questions? Those who are joined in the Zoom, please feel free to put in the chat box. I will take it up either now or at the end. So thank you. Yeah, it looks like there are no further questions. So I'll probably move on to the next presentation from Mr. Subang. So just let me log out of this and try to go share the screen. I'll stop sharing the screen. And yeah, there we are. Let's go back to the beginning of the slide. Excellent. So this is the second part of the presentation. A lot of doctors have really asked for this. I think today, as I say, it's Subang's birthday. India has hit the bulls, 60,000, you know, has never done it. And I think I was looking at papers today, and I think they managed to do it in the last 6 to 7 months, which is incredible. Mr. Subang, over to you. The podium is yours.
Yeah, hi friends. Thank you, Mr. Srikanth. Thanks for the opportunity you gave to us. So hi friends, I'm Subhav. So I'm an independent financial advisor working on the investment arena for the last 17 years. So here I am just here to present about how we should plan our investments and what are the ways we can do that. So basically, there are various ways in which we can earn money. So one is some people inherit wealth from the ancestors, some inherit and then they are able to multiply the wealth as well. Some are simply smart and lucky in terms of winning lotteries, which very few of us are basically gunning for. Then some of them are basically who have earned it in the hard way in terms of they have creative minds. Some have become global leaders in terms of creating new ideas and applying to it and sticking to it. Some of the lucky ones have become successful by redeploying it in a very successful way. And they keep on developing this art. Some are disruptors in their own ideas, just like Zerodha or Ola and others, who create new ideas and then disrupt the entire industry. Some are young entrepreneurs who build empires by doing very innovative work. And most of us basically earn it and then have to save it the hard way. So 90% or 95% fall in the same category. So this is an important slide. So what can our investments get us? So as a layman, we need to understand that inflation on an average is between 6.6% to 6.5%. Now our aim should be to get better than that so that at least the money does not degrow. Money grows from there. So if we see the past track record for the last 10 years, We have seen government securities giving it around 9.25% type of a return, because earlier in last 7-8 years, we have seen interest rates at the higher side of it. Gold has been giving us a consistent 6-7% return. So there will be many years where gold will not give you any return, but suddenly it will spike up the returns, just like we have seen it in the last year. Then there are fixed deposits. So earlier we have seen fixed deposits ranging to around 10-11% as well within the last decade. And then now we are in the phase where we see fixed deposits in the range of around 6-7%. That is again on the higher side, but most of the bank fixed deposits are in the range of 5.5-6.5%. The outperformance comes from the equity investments. I am not only referring to a direct equity stock. It can be any equity investment which has a base of a stock market. So whether it can be a mutual fund or any other PMS type of investments. So any equity investment in the last 10 years has given a return of around 12%. So this basically is an average out return. So overall, this basically helps us in determining that yes, equities is one of the consistent performing asset class which has given us the returns. So this is a very interesting slide. So how can we associate with a bank which is named as HDFC Bank? So if we have deposited a lakh of rupees in 2011 with the same banks, today the value would have been around 2,10,000 rupees. Whereas if we have invested in the same stock of HDFC Bank with a lakh of rupees, the current value would have been around 6.5 lakh rupees. That means because the stocks are growing or the equity market is growing, the returns on the stocks are increasing better. So this is the similar description of the previous slide on the chart. So we can see how the blue line is basically the FD returns as well as the black line indicates the stock returns. So this is how most of us will argue or will say that why can't we invest in a real estate? So real estate has given us a very good return in the earlier times, but in the last 3-4 years, due to some of the, I will say, internal reasons, the real estate returns have dropped down. So whether it can be a RERA thing or it can be a demonetization thing or whether it can be last 2 years or 1.5 years of corona pandemic, so real estate has become a very non-performing asset class. Whereas if we see on the return side on the Nifty part, which is the red line, so we have seen both of them were basically trailing on the similar sides, plus minus 5%, 10% here and there. But suddenly in the last 1 year, we have seen the returns coming up from the Nifty index. This is one of the very interesting slides which shows us that how the Indian equity market has been performing for the last 7-8 years. So if we see India's equity returns have been very consistent in terms of in the top four categories across the world. So no doubt the debt market has also given us a return, but consistently if we see equity has been there in one of the key areas. So Benjamin Graham used to say stock markets are like voting machines in the short term, but weighing machines in the long term. That means as we grow older, we generally tend to gain weight. If we have to invest in the stock market, we need to have some more patience and let it grow. So unlike the other avenues of investment, where we generally park it for 1 year or 2 years or 3 years, when we are investing into a stock market, we should have an option, we should have a clear horizon of 3-5 years plus category. So the basic difference comes in when we plan to start the investments. So there is no time frame to it. We can start investing today also. If somebody says, we have missed the bus of investments in the stock market because stock market is at 60,000 levels, I completely differ on that. So there is no time, there is no, I will say, there is no delay in timing of investment. So we can start investment as and when we want to start with, but your horizon should be clear on it. So the issue with some of the larger economies as well as some of the emerging market is larger economies have basically seen most of the cycles in their stock market as well as in their economy. Whereas the emerging markets, just like India or Brazil or other countries, are still having some of the other economy related issues which they are developing it. So the returns on the emerging market will certainly be better. So if we see in the last 36 years, we have seen various things happening in and around the world, especially in India as well. We have seen two major wars happening with our neighbors and things. Then we have seen a lot of tension situations with our neighbors, assassination of two prime ministers, at least three recessionary periods, whether it is a subprime time or it is 1998 times. So we have seen three recessions overall. Well, different governments coming in and going out, unfair shares of natural disasters, and then we are currently in the corona pandemic. But still, if we see 100 rupee invested in 36 years back is currently, or to be precise, in 1986, is currently at around 600 rupees or 600 times of it. So that means certainly the BSE Sensex or the index clearly outperformed the market. This is a very interesting slide which shows that since the starting of the last 2000 years, how the market share of a country has changed. If we see in the initial 2000 years, India used to have a major wallet share of the global economy. But then suddenly it started dipping up and China has taken over and US has taken over it. And for the last 5-7 years, we have seen the graph increasing on the India side. So it's the, it will keep compounding sensible people wealth. So the basic point is that, yes, we should not stop thinking that if the markets are at 60,000 levels, whether it will go up or go down. So my view is markets will not stop for anything. The tendency of the market is a volatile nature. It will certainly move up, but with some volatility in will keep on happening. So then there is no timeline. So the day you plan to invest, you should start investing, whether in a lump sum way or through an SIP way, absolutely okay for an investment. And this is a very good proverb which is there. A best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The second best time is now, because we never know how the next 20 years will work. We might see in the next 20 years, or we might see Sensex at 1.25 lakhs as well. So rather than looking at past 36 years where Sensex moved only 60,000 points, so we should not worry about the numbers of the Sensex. We should always look at the opportunity which is there in the future. There are a lot of options on the product side, which can be a mutual fund, it can be a portfolio management services, it can be an unlisted stock, it can be bonds and structures. So the thing, the list of the options are various. So we need to basically pick and choose the right investment for your strategies, for your long-term, medium-term and long-term goals, and then start deploying the funds. So that's all from my side. If we have any questions, I can take it up and we can see how it I can work it on.
Thanks, Paul. So probably I'll access that for questions. If you sure. Come back and answer.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, Subhav. That was a fantastic presentation. So really enjoyed it. So I think, you know, today being a bull market, I think this was the best presentation we were all waiting for. And the timing could not have been better than that. So I just stopped sharing Subhav's slides. And let me go back to the questions. We have some questions, you know, for him. So let's move on to this. Just give me a sec to bring the questions up. I welcome Dr. Arun Mishra, who has joined us now from Mumbai. Welcome, sir. Thank you very much for joining.
Thank you. Thank you, dear. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And I welcome all the friends who have joined on Ortho TV. So there are a number of them who have joined there. So let me bring up my slides. So just give me a second. Okay, share screen. Right. So this section is called Banker in the Hot Seat. I think a few months ago, I did a session called, Judiciary in the Hot Seat. We had a senior high court lawyer from the state of Karnataka who had joined. It was fun going through all the things, status of where judiciary is there in India. So this is directed towards the banker, actually. So we really need desperate answers for some of the questions so that we can, really help our patients and the country. Mr. Subha, if you can make unmute yourself on your side, on your laptop, and I will start asking you the question. The first question that I want to know is, what is the state of the global economy in this pandemic? So what is the state that we've got, the global economy? Could you answer? You can answer.
So on the global economy, we are, as far as we are comparing it with the last year, we are recovering well on the economy side, all the global economies. So we need to look at the two perspectives here. Overall, in the last 10 years, how the economies have performed. So economies have performed in a very decent way, considering the last year as a pandemic year. So some of the emerging economies have taken the right strategies to follow, and they were the first. They have taken the first initiative to become independent in terms of the global part. So there were the few economies were able to recover faster as compared to other economies.
That's great. So my second question is, why all governments, including Indian government, are forced to invest in healthcare during this pandemic, and how a doctor can take advantage of this and move away from austerity in healthcare? If you look at the, I was talking about my experience in the UK. If you look at both America and Europe, in the last 15 years, they've been saying austerity in healthcare, cut down costs. That's been the mantra. And suddenly that's changed. And again, India has never invested in healthcare, which all the doctors who are joining will agree. So how can a doctor take advantage of the situation, right?
That's a very interesting question. So if we see India's percentage allocation in the budget to the healthcare sector is around 1.6-1.7%. Whereas if we compare it to some of the bigger economies like US, which is around 16-17%. So, but the whole point is US allocation to healthcare has been 16-17%, but still US healthcare is not the best. So we need to invest in the right direction in the healthcare sector so that the healthcare becomes more stronger. If the healthcare is stronger, certainly if we look at from the different perspective of the cost saving wise, it saves a lot of cost for the economy as well. So investing in the right direction makes sense rather than just increasing the allocation of the budget. So if I have to name a few economies, like Switzerland is one of the economies which are good in healthcare, then we have Sweden, then we have Germany, who are good in their healthcare. But those are not the best economies in terms of deploying the funds. So we need to start investing in the right direction in the healthcare sector so that the overall sector becomes very self-sufficient.
Okay, so as suppose you're a loan expert, and with the COVID, a lot of doctors are very keen on the COVID loan, really. What money is available with via various banking sectors for doctors, and how to access it? Because always getting loan from banks is very difficult if you're a very straightforward kind of a person.
So for a loan part, I think most of the banks especially run schemes for the healthcare sector or for the doctors as well. But yes, because most of the doctors are on a consultancy basis or have their own clinics and hospitals, things vary. So the best answer is, I will say, we need to look at the right loan segments, because most Indian government is also putting a lot of focus on the loans for the doctors. So we need to have the right category, and we need to know the right category in which we need to apply for the loan.
Yeah, honestly, around 70,000 plus crores have been invested into Indian healthcare due to pandemic. So would you say, what's the best loan or deal for doctor entrepreneurs in India today?
So I think a lot of options are available in terms of the SME loans as well, in terms of, so most of the loans are also now available in terms of the, you can say, the your equipment loans and everything. So government is focusing more on the giving more flexibility in terms of loans to the doctors and healthcare sector.
Okay. I think you mentioned, what's the best investment which beats, the investment which beats both inflation and the tax is the best investment. I think you dealt with that in your presentation. And you also dealt with the, what is the real inflation? Because I thought my inflation was 7%. But if you look at my lifestyle and travel and everything, it's definitely not 7%. It's more than 12%. So I think, any kind of investment should outperform that inflation rather than just beating 7%, which the government gives, really. And how Wealthy.in can help to achieve the above objectives, really?
So basically, me and my team can certainly work out in terms of the right investment avenues which are suitable for your lifestyle and for your long-term objectives. So every person has a different objective and a goal in their minds. So we need to work accordingly so that both the teams or both the people are clear and are having a right synchronization for meeting the objectives.
Okay. Indemnity insurance, I think Dr. Advocate Arun Mishra sir is going to deal in detail, so I'll not go to that. But, what would you say, what is the best life insurance and health insurance in India today?
So currently, I will say in India, we are very underly covered in terms of our health insurance and life insurance. It's hardly 3-4% of the total population is covered through a life insurance, and apart from the government schemes, if we see, it is very minimal on the health insurance side. So my suggestion is, at least everybody, a working professional, should have a basic term plan or a life insurance covered attached to it, and at least everyone should be having a family health policy in terms of a health insurance cover. So that these are two basic things which a person should be taking care of it, so that in case of any eventuality, the family is well taken care of.
Right. So, the last slide for Mr. Subbau is, they say that the poor don't pay any taxes, the rich avoid taxes, the middle class pay all the taxes. The rich argue that they are job creators and wealth creators and they grow economy. Hence, why should they be taxed for a nation building? Is there strength in this kind of argument, Subha? What do you say?
So every economy works on the similar lines. So we can always debate there is no agriculture tax, or there is very less tax for the lower middle class or the other categories. But yes, we should also see, or we should face the responsibility as, yes, we are the ones who are building the nation in the right direction. If we stop paying taxes, where will the government do spending for? And how will the government get money to spend on the development of the country as well? So I think paying taxes is the right way, and this is how a nation should be built.
Okay, that's a great answer, Subbau. That's a great answer. What's the difference between lending process in a public sector bank versus a private sector bank? And what's your opinion about these lending cards and other kind of app-based loans, really?
So as far as the difference between a public sector bank and a private sector bank is, I will say there is a very less difference in terms, because everything is governed by RBI regulation. So as far as taking loan or borrowing funds from lending card or other similar apps is concerned, these apps offer, again, they also do their own due diligence in terms of taking, giving you the loans. So more or less the process remains same, but yes, all these new startups or the fintech companies are slightly faster as compared to the banking structures, no doubt on it.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Shubham. And you know, Ashok, if there's no questions on from the Ortho TV side, we'll move on. You know, Mr. Arun, Dr. Arun Mishra sir has joined from Mumbai, so we'll go on. So I'll again reintroduce sir again. It's a pleasure to welcome Advocate Dr. Arun Mishra sir. And you know, as I said in the beginning, you know, I'm really flabbergasted by the amount of qualifications sir has got. He's a PhD, he's a MBBS and MD, he's a LLM, he's a double MA, and he has done BSc in microbiology, diploma in pharma, diploma in yoga, advanced PG in mysticism and mythology, and DMLT. He's a practicing advocate for Honorable High Court and Supreme Court of India. He's a medical legal consultant, a criminal and a corporate lawyer. He provides doctor's risk medical legal service. He's a LLM crime from Mumbai University. I mean, he has got 3 degrees in medicine, microbiology and law. And he has 3 postgraduate degrees in medicine, yoga and law. Incredible and amazing. And he's one of the best medical legal consultants in India, with success rate close to 100%. And he has handled more than 16,000 medical legal cases in the last 16 years with use of the latest medical legal laws, High Court and Supreme Court judgments, you know, just like medicine, where we have to update our knowledge and skill and why these CMEs are done. In legal profession also, they have to update and they can't quote a judgment from 1800 and argue a case. So, you know, so he has authored a book called The Law of Medicine, which runs into 8 volumes. And his aim is to increase awareness and, most importantly, unity and confidence among doctors through his Voice of Doctors approach to bring medical fraternity together, which is very, very important in today's world. And I was speaking to Professor Nandimat, Professor of Law in National School of Law in Bangalore a few weeks ago. And he told, you know, Dr. Srikant, you know, as a lawyer and as a professor of law, you know, we really don't understand, you know, where the shoe of the doctor pinches. And the only way to really represent a doctor truly in the court of law is to be a doctor yourself. Then you know where the shoe pinches, then you can really bail out your clients. So here is one such doctor turned advocate who really can bail us out from difficult, tricky situations. So I welcome Dr. Arun Mishra sir for his valuable time. And I'll stop sharing this slide and sir can give us a talk on medical indemnity. Where are we in 2021? What's the best indemnity? Followed by question and answers. Thank you, sir. Welcome, sir.
So good evening, friends. Thank you, Dr. Srikant, for such a brief introduction. But I am blessed that my father was a school teacher and he always used to say me, the best way of learning is teaching. Because you get lots of questions which make you understand about the topic. Every time you cannot give 100% answer to all the questions, but in bargain, you learn a lot. So I strongly believe in interactive programs so that both the people get a benefit as two-sided. And second thing, what my father always used to say, that if you want to success in your life, be a student always. Because if you are a student, you will be egoless. You will not go against the principle of Guru and Shishya. With his guidance, today also I am a part and parcel of Mumbai University doing some of the courses just to upgrade my knowledge so that I can share the things with the people. Friend, if I talk about medical law, what rightly said by Dr. Srikant, and naturally, every colleagues of mine who are in a practical practice very well knows that what is the scenario situation today. Let it be a criminal liability, or could be a civil liability in the form of consumer 4-hour civil court or a medical counsel liability. We are always vulnerable. In spite of giving all best to the patient to save their life, we never been spared if at all any case gone wrong or something wrong has happened because of even a paramedical staff or because of any of the person per se. People don't understand that how sleepless night doctor slips when any problem comes, even in natural scenario or in a complication. but only because of the some dispute arised due to the medical bill or arise due to the paramedical staff's behavior, it is again a doctor who need to face a dance of all laws, including the violence. To avoid all this, what I have experienced in 16 years of my career in medical law by handling 16,000 plus issues, that only best thing which we can do for our community is to educate them in the law. Because law is very good for the doctor if they know it. There's a huge good judgments and the acts which protects the doctor. But since we are not aware about this, we really fear and we get terrorized if anything goes wrong with me or with any of them. Being an ortho crowd, let me share a few cases before I go for the defenses and other part. How the cases goes in court of law and how we are troubled. Let me share the ortho cases to you. I have got a case where orthopedic surgeon has done a plating on radius ulna in a patient, charged 35,000 rupees, called a patient for follow-up, and naturally if any problem he faces, he can anytime contact a doctor. This patient never turned up, maybe because of the plaster, itching, another problem. After a month, he went to some general practitioner who referred to his own orthopedic surgeon. That orthopedic surgeon, knowing that it is going to take a little time for healing, wanted to do the surgery, advise the patient that healing is not there, we need to go for another surgery. And he done a bone grafting, could be because there could be a gap. And again charged the patient hefty amount of 45,000. Patient definitely got annoyed, asked the doctor, and professional rivalry in very micro interiors, interiors I have seen very common with my experience. The other orthopedic surgeon, I don't know why, instigated the matter by educating a patient, referred to some of advocate who was a relative of this doctor, probably the brother of this doctor, who filed a case in various places against the doctor. Since there was no much evidence to prove there is a medical negligence on a part of a doctor and patient was alive, even police station has not entertained the complaint. But advocates are advocates. This advocate has filed a private complaint in court of law under the CRPC. Private complaint is allowed if police don't entertain. And he filed a case against his doctor under IPC section of 406, 420, 336 and 37. Process got issued and ultimately doctor need to take a bail. And the matter started when this doctor somewhere contacted me. I was utter surprised to see such a complaint gone against the doctor and not been defended properly. What rightly said by Dr. Srikanth, the normal advocates are good advocates, but they are good in their field. And when it comes to the medical field, they also struggle with medical terminology and take the case in the same spirit which they have taken other cases of criminality. Because we can't expect that everyone knows everything. But law is very clear that if at all you want to fasten any criminal case against the doctor, you need to have an expert's opinion which of the same field, which was not taken in that case. But why 406? Now, what is the 406 of IPC? It says causing criminal breach of trust. And 420 is cheating. And that advocate has presented to court that I, being a patient, went to this doctor who has cheated me criminally by not giving a proper treatment. Because there was a trust factor which was a foundation between me and this doctor, which was broken criminally by this doctor. Followed by 420, that is a cheating of a money which this doctor has taken. Surprisingly, court has accepted this argument and process was issued. I suggested this doctor to immediately file a writ petition in the High Court to quash this. Because if this becomes the precedent in a country with one or two cases, it is going to be troublesome for my doctor to practice, because 100% patient which goes to any doctor is only the basis of trust, and not getting a result means is going to get converted to criminal breach of trust. It is really a case which opened the eyes. I could able to do a justice with this doctor. But it, the common doctor naturally don't know what to do in such a scenario, how to argue and present their case, and what need to be guided to the advocates. In any cases, we are going to discuss that. Let me share another case with you. Very recently, very latestly, I got a case from Bangalore itself, where the person who was a colleague in yoga class with one of physician suddenly got pachec sprain in lumbar spine. She has given some medicine. Being a colleague of yoga and being a doctor, she said, if you don't get relief, you can contact these doctors. She has recommended some orthopedic surgeon. And she said, I am in a government hospital in Bangalore. You can go to private hospital, or you can come to government hospital also. I'll see that you get a best treatment. This patient went to this physician in a government hospital. She introduced that particular colleague of her to that orthopedic department. The senior surgeon, the HOD, was not there. The associate professor must have examined and instructed houseman to give a diclofenac injection as a painkiller, which was given by the doctor again. Patient got infection, abscess, got admitted to another hospital, then third hospital, went in septicemia and died. After the death, the family of this particular patient was good earner, had filed 28 crore compensation case against the doctor, against the government hospital, against the private hospital, and all doctors in that particular domain, including this referring doctor. I was approached by a referring doctor. I could able to give her justice by discharging her from National Commission in that case, because her role was not defined in a case. But still the matter is going court of law of 28 crores of death due to injection abscess in ortho case. Then 15 days back, I have got a case where this lady has gone to orthopedic surgeon with a lumbar pain. After examining, the orthopedic surgeon has advised epidural injection. She agreed to, on OPD basis, epidural was given. Patient went in cardiac arrest. Patient was resuscitated, shifted to tertiary care center, from where patient was again shifted to government hospital, and ultimately after 2 days, patient died. ADR got filed, police machineries intervened, patient created his own cry, and finally we could able to advise the doctor, and they came to the common term of settling outside the court, which can be done now because the CPA Act has included the mediation chapter, that is inside court. The document can be submitted on the same ground to safeguard any scenario situation. But the grossest mistake even done by the doctor I have seen in many of the cases. With this reference, I am giving an example of another reference where even if at all settlement agreement is made between two parties for out of court settlement or otherwise, if not been done properly, it can become a dangerous to the doctor if doctor don't take a help of any medical legal expert to make a document. There was a good case of orthopedic surgeon where this bachu was taken to this orthopedic surgeon for radio ulna fracture, or it is radius fracture probably, where doctor has plastered because bone were close to each other. Advise the patient to show that bachchu could not able to give a proper explanation of the agony what bachchu was facing. With severe pain when father has taken, there was already a compartment syndrome. Ultimately referred to the hospital where they need to ampute the hand. They came to common settlement. Settlement was done and paper was made. But in that paper, the very clear admission of negligence and of settlement was done without any proper documentation. The patient has used the same document and filed a consumer court case thereafter and used the same document to prove that it is an admission from the doctor's side that there's a gross medical negligence happened and he want to wipe up the case by some peanut amount where the hand of the bachchu was amputated. My friend, lots of cases are going court of law, including in a medical councils, where suspension of registration I have seen in many of the cases. Earlier it was 3 days, 7 days, but nowadays it is 1 month, 2 months. It is very important for us to really defend ourselves. In a changing world and changing laws in our country also, it becomes imperative for every single doctor to protect themselves. Because legality, if I talk in country, is going to be now all India. With the new law of CPA Act 2019, where complainant can file a complaint, where he reside or work for gain, made very difficult situation for my doctors because they treat a patient in a city area where patient has migrated from various places of the country or working in a metropolitan city or metro cities, goes to the doctor and residing in Orissa or Tamil Nadu or Kerala, I got all the advantage to trouble my doctor in Kerala or Tamil Nadu in Orissa. Where sitting at Mumbai or sitting at Chennai or sitting at Bangalore, you need to defend your case across the country. The development and need of the change made it mandatory for government to come out with a good laws for the doctors. And very recent past, we have seen the telemedicine law, which is now legal in a country, where my doctors have started doing telemedicine practice across the country on the basis of these guidelines. And the telemedicine practice, which is now been common in India, again attracts the cases across the country because of telemedicine, you are going to treat a patient of across the country. And we can expect cases anywhere in the country, making it difficult for the doctors to protect and defend themselves. But friend, let me tell you, if we are vigilant, we can easily defend ourselves. The amount of compensation, the upper limit has not been defined in this country, leading to huge compensation cases in country. I'll tell you, I have got a cases of 30 crores in cesarean death, 28 crores in orthopedic injection abscess death, 10 crore plus in multiple cases where patient is alive, 5 crore plus is the commonest thing. The new law has opened the domain of asking for higher compensation. The various judgment of Honorable Supreme Court and state commissions and Nestle Commission made it easier for the complainant to file a complaint of higher compensation, made it difficult for the doctors. But still, I have seen in the country, with my experience, let me share you very honestly. Doctors are not vigilant. One reason which I could able to find is a very clear, the ignorance of the future. They don't know what is going to be the future if at all I don't handle the case at this stage. Ignorance of uncertainty. I have found many of the doctors discussing with me, "Yes, sir, I am practicing from last 15 years. No case has happened against me. Why I need a protection? Why I need a knowledge?" Many doctors said, "I am already senior surgeon and now senior citizen also, crossed 60 years of my life. I don't need any protection." Many of doctors say that I am advising other doctors. I am confident of handling my cases. Why I should need a protection? Lots of myths are there. But friend, with my experience in medical law, let me share you. Today, we are in a country where the population of the country is around 70 crores below 25 years age group and 90 crores below 35 years age group are the people who takes decision in the house, are the people who pay for the health for their parents, are the people who believe in social media, are the people who take review before going to the or before sending their parent to the doctor, and they are working on the basis of consumerism, not on the basis of trust, which my doctors have enjoyed earlier, which my senior siddhan and senior surgeons have enjoyed in those days where the trust was the only factor. So in the life of consumerism, it becomes very important for my doctors to defend themselves. When I talk about defense, I always say criminal liability, my doctors should not worry. Police call, they should not fear. Police summon, they should not get a sleepless night because law is there to protect them. The beautiful judgment of Honorable Supreme Court in Jacob Matthew case, where they defined criminal liability, has given a clear-cut protection in criminal liability to doctor. It says that medical science is a complex science which is beyond imagination of any medical practitioner. Hence, medical accident in the form of death, the doctor must not be held responsible if due care has been given. Has made an easy life to my doctors when I talk about criminal liability. The guidelines very clearly says that advocates are not a doctor, police authorities are not a doctor, being an expert field. If any criminal liability need to be fastened, it is mandate that the expert opinion must be taken and that to be of same qualified doctor, preferably in government hospital, which has made a shield around my doctor when I talk about criminal liability. If at all we know the law, I can confidently say that majority of case, we can defend ourselves at the police station level itself with all the confidence. When I talk about civil liability, as Dr. Srikanth has very rightly said, we need to get protected by professional indemnity policy. The insurance policy, in layman language, when I talk about liability policy, it is as good as a Mediclaim policy. You need to have, in today's scenario of health sector, even if you are an orthopedic surgeon, even if you are a doctor, when you get admitted to corporate hospital, for them, you are a consumer. They will not leave you. They will charge you also. They are the MBA graduates. They are not a professional that they are going to check and see their doctors. They see money. And if you don't have a Mediclaim, then you need to spend from pocket. So my doctors takes a Mediclaim policy. If not been used, it remains. But once it is used, all 10 years premium you recover, rather more than that. Same applies to your professional indemnity policy. Even if you are a 15-year-old practitioner having a 15-year-old policies and never been used in your life, it does not mean that in future you're not going to. But once, if at all, scenario situation comes, you will feel proud to have a policy with you. I have seen that when 2 crore compensation case notice comes, I'm talking about a simple 2 crores. I'm not talking about 20 crores. also threaten a doctor, because then he start worrying that he need to sell his hospital if at all it goes against the doctor, because he don't have an indemnity policy. Then he realized that how important it is. And notice today is a very common friend. So every doctor need to have a professional indemnity policy. This policy was made in 1991 when first time medical practices was brought under the purview of consumerism. Underwriter had made the policy with that current situation. Today in our country, medical and health sector has grown like anything. And today we have reached to the stage in technology where technology become the blessing for my doctors. And we are using all advanced technology process for treating a doctor, not treating a patient. But the indemnity policy which you will have, you go and check your own policy. I've got all the exclusion clauses, because those days it was not available. Like telemedicine, teleconsultation, second opinion, online consultation, cosmetic domain. These are not covered in during those days. But now customized policies are available. I'm running Doctors Risk Medical Legal Services, an organization to protect a doctor in Mumbai from last 15 years. In changing era, I have negotiated with every insurance company to protect my doctor in best cost, and I could able to reach to that negotiation today, where I could able to create a policy for the doctors in peanut amount, covering all possible things which need to be covered, known as customized policy. Now, customized policy covers the greatest thing which need to be covered is the legal fees across the country, because it is need of the hour. If at all you got a case in Uttar Pradesh, you case in Orissa, even if you are staying in Chennai, your brother may be advocate, but he is not useful to you when matter goes to North India, because local language is going to be troublesome for him. And then to and fro to Uttar Pradesh is going to cost more than the fees you are going to pay to the legal. So by and large, you are going to pay a legal fees. If your policy covers the legal fees, I think this is one of the best bargain you have got in any of the zone. The customized policy covers out-of-court settlement. Customized policy covers latest technologies. Customized policy is 1:1. Means one case of 1 crore or 5 cases of 20 lakhs, everything is covered. And greatest thing, my friend, is a cashless option in that. Because I've seen that if 1 crore compensation award is given, the old policy, which is reimbursement policy, always says that doctor should pay first. And if doctor don't have a 1 crore, from where he is going to pay? And then insurance company will not reimburse you. And if you pay, then insurance company comes with some clauses to repudiate your claim, like in medical policy. And then you fight with insurance company separately and pay 1 crore here or go to jail. This my doctor is not vigilant enough to know that. So my doctor takes a policy to just give a peace to their mind without understanding what is mentioned in the policy. And second worst part, which I have seen in my doctors across the country, okay, when it comes to their own protection, they bargain. They cannot spend. In spite of huge income they have got, they don't invest on self. They really don't. They will go to bar, pay a bill of 10,000. For sharing their cases which patient has filed against him, to share their pain with their colleagues and friend circle, but they will not pay 10,000 for insurance policy. They will go for the trip, They will go and spend everything, but they will not spend on themselves. I don't know why they bargain in the care cases where they need most. They will search for the insurance company without authenticating it, without knowing what they are paying, whom they are paying. But if at all they charge 4,000 or 5,000 for the policy, they will jump into that company. Never ever tried to find out the reason why they are giving 4,000 or 5,000 for 50 lakhs or 1 crore, where standard rate applies is 10,000 or 12,000. There could be some reason, no? If the matter comes to their own family, to their child and their wife and their parent, they will spend huge amount in health sector in spite of having a hospital of their own friend circle where they will get a free treatment. They will not admit their own people. They will admit to corporate hospitals, spend a huge money. They will not take a generic medicine which is 80% cheaper. They will go for the branded medicine when it comes to their own family. They will spend anything, but they will not spend on self. And then they cry when the case goes in court of law and it gets repudiated. Friend, we don't buy Chinese item, which is very cheaper, because we know the life in a month where the other quality products available in little costly can give a good life to your child, including the injury which can be saved. So same applies to indemnity policy, friend. Now, indemnity policy is only policy which covers your compensation part. So if you are with any of the insurance company and only had an insurance policy, it is not going to be useful to you, my friend. Because what is the indemnity? Indemnity means if any loss has happened to you during your practice, we are going to make it good. That is a promise done by insurance company. But the matter goes in court of law. They will tell that engage my advocate. The advocate is going to get little 6,000, 8,000 rupees for whole case. Are going to be helpful to you? Ask yourself. Ask yourself, are going to give your child's life to intern? Are you going to rush to expert pediatrician? So naturally, when it comes to your own case, you are going to engage a good advocate to save your money and life. And then you tend to pay lakhs of rupees where the good policies are available covering a legal piece of your choice advocate. But because of some cost, you have not engaged or taken the policy. You have gone and bargained the policy which is of low price, but you never ever asked agent why so low price. The normal advocate you engage in a court of law, friend, are struggling with medical terminologies. They don't know what is asphyxia and hypoxia, and such a case has gone to the court of law when my doctor has lost the case. For every case, you need to depend upon your advocate. An advocate is dependent on you. And both are not connected to each other. Both are egoistic people. Don't give time to each other. And my doctor loses the case because drafting document is submitted to the court goes against them. So indemnity policy comes in a picture when case goes in consumer fora and decided against you. But in medical practice, no doctor wanted to have cases against them. So for the purpose of the same, it is admittedly important that you need to have a medico-legal service with indemnity policy. I'll tell you what is this mean, medico-legal services. Medico-legal services means you got a medico-legal expert on a fingertip. In a pre-litigation, where patient has asked for the paper or argued with you, you know he is going to be potent litigant. You can call your medical legal expert and do an audit of your IPD or OPD paper, because medical records are going to go to the court of law and medical records are only going to be defense by you. So you got an opportunity to audit your paper. You got an opportunity to make your paper foolproof so that you get a benefit. Moreover, answering a notices which is not covered in indemnity policy, if you do a proper way, majority of time I found with my experience that opponent advocate, if he's working on a percentage basis, are going to drop the case unless he's getting a fees. Litigation goes off. So pre-litigation supports are much needed in every scenario situation. During litigation, the most important aspect during litigation, you need to have a support of medical legal people. During surgery, if at all death has happened, you got enough opportunity to make a proper paper. And if you got a medical legal expert, you can immediately exchange your paper before declaring the death to the relatives. Exchange paper, look from the medical angle, look from the legal angle, make it foolproof. Understand from medical legal expert that how and what way you are going to declare a death. What are the methodology of communication at this stage? You understand from the medical legal expert that how, if at all, mob is going to come. You're predicting a young death. You can handle the scenario situation. How the media people can be handled. These are not covered under indemnity policy, but you need to have a combination of indemnity policy with medical legal services altogether. Post-litigation, when drafting documentation done and submitted in court of law, if you got a medical legal expert with you, in your busy hours, he can be a great support for drafting documentation, going through the document, making full proof for you and helping you. In latest scenario where our practices are dependent upon digital media, social media marketing, new CPA Act, which has covered advertisement very, very strictly, where penalties of 10 lakh and 50 lakhs for misleading advertisement, you need always the support of medical legal people. Further to that, my friend, many of the time you have seen that youngsters are defaming you in court of defaming you on social media and digital marketing media and other things, where your reputation is at stake. Your medical legal experts are always there to help you by sending a defamation notice to these people, criminal and civil. And this is my personal experience with single notices. Majority of time I found that people apologize immediately and remove their post from your social media, which protects your life altogether. Recovery of your hard-earned money is very important. I have seen my doctors spending or losing a lakhs of rupees in a year, which is unpaid by the patient. Either he has ran away or given a part payment or given a check which got bounced. My doctor don't do anything, but take a help of a medical legal expert and send a recovery notice. If you don't want to go to court also, send at least notice. I have seen that notice works good. Even if you can recover 50% of your amount in a year, I think this is better bargain. By spending 10, 20,000 a year on a medical legal service and professional indemnity policy, if you can save your skin and get a benefit of recovery also, I think this is one of the best bargain in the country. There are lots of things which you need to discuss with your medical legal support in wee hours. Support from such a people are going to be helpful to you. But my advice, that all my medical legal people are good, but advisable, that always choose to be a people who are practicing lawyer in a medical law, because the theory and practical plays a vital role. Even I was working as a theoretical lawyer prior to I surrendered my degree and opted for bar counsel and went to the court. When I went to the court, I found that lots of new learning lots of new things, and this practical experience of mine have helped me to score over, and today I really guide my people on the basis of practical knowledge. At what time, what action need to be taken. Saying it very clear, friend. कि मुसीबत बता के नहीं आती, प्रॉब्लम हाउ इज गोइंग टू कम, एट व्हाट एज इज गोइंग टू कम, यू आर नॉट अवेयर ऑफ. सो यू आर ऑफ एज ऑफ 70 इयर्स एंड इफ यू आर प्रैक्टिसिंग, इफ योर एज इज 60 इयर्स स्टिल यू आर प्रैक्टिसिंग, इफ लास्ट 20 इयर्स यू हैव नॉट गॉट अ केस, डोंट अंडर एस्टिमेट दैट यू आर नॉट गोइंग टू केस अगेन. इन टुडे सिनेरियो द कंज्यूमरिज्म हैज गॉन वेरी हाई. Information technology made it is easy for the people to search on internet and get whatever they want. In an era of social media, we can't protect ourselves. In all scenarios, situation, you need to have the best people to protect you. Dr. Sisk Medical Legal Services is one organization working for the doctors and protecting doctors, where I am heading the organization, has done a great job in this country. And I proudly say that my knowledge has helped my colleague. Where 16,000 issues which I have handled, every day I get one serious critical case and around 15, 16 other cases. I have seen that timely support to my doctor resolve the matter, and not even 0.5% cases gone to the court of law. That is what is the strength of medical legal organization. Doctors and medical legal services, friend, provide you customized indemnity policies, provide you medical legal services. I am practicing in Supreme Court and High Court. I have seen my doctors definitely wanted to contact me, and they say, sir, I feel bad because you are of that level that we fear to call you. Where I never keep an ego, I never say no to my doctor, but I don't know what psych they have got. But friend, the purpose of the same, I always advise to my friend, be a part to Doctor's Risk. At least you have got in your mind that I have taken a support from Doctor's Risk. You will not fear to call me. In otherwise, if you want to meet a Supreme Court lawyer, just try and go and meet for any case. The consulting start from 25,000 onwards minimum, one onset. In a year, you can contact me any number of time. So Doctors Medical Legal Services, friend, not only offering you one of the best thing where they protect you for criminal case, civil case, medical counsel case, provide a professional indemnity policy, provide a medical legal service policy, also educate the people because education plays a vital role, provide a medical legal courses, medical legal tips. And the greatest thing, to protect a doctor, they do every possible things. And telemedicine law, I have seen that my doctors were exploited like anything in telemedicine by aggregators in this country. We could be able to have a tie up with some of the telemedicine who works for the doctor. Don't exploit a doctor. I will advise you. On a Play Store, there is a two software available of My Wellness Technology. One known as Direct Doc. It's a free software for the doctor. You can download that. You can upload your medical registration as a service provider. You can choose your own fees. You can choose your own time. And you can enjoy 80 to 90% of your fees. 10% to 15% only goes for the maintaining a medical record in cloud, for the servicing of software, for maintenance of software. So almost 90% fees you recover, which no aggregator in this country gives. I know one software known as Complete Wellness. Complete Wellness is a software. They help you in the marketing also. The same system, but only difference between both that you get 50% in Complete Wellness because 50% goes to marketing. In Direct Doc, you get 90%, 85 to 90%, where naturally direct, indirect marketing is done by doctor also, because if any patient of Mumbai you treated got well, that Mumbai patient can bring you n number of patients from Mumbai. You sitting at Chennai can treat Mumbai patient and explore your horizon to all India and enjoy 85-90%. But protections are there in softwares. So we do all sort of activity where I can protect my doctor. We can really do good for the doctors. So it is very important for my doctors to always look for a few things which as a part of defense. One, your medical record. I am not there to speak on medical record. My videos are available on YouTube, on Doctors Risk YouTube, or if you Dr. Mishra, because I've spoken on medical record for almost a series of 10 lectures in an elaborate way, how the paper medical record you must have. So medical record is a very, very prime defense. Professional indemnity from Doctors Risk tied up with the government insurance company is going to be a great protection to you in a low cost, because I have seen that my doctor are worried about the cost of that also been negotiated. Medico-legal services, the third defense. Doctors is one, remaining is your choice. Fourth, medico-legal education. Yes, doctors is definitely providing you that. And fifth, important is the communication part and training part, which we are going to start again as a new horizon for the doctors, for training their paramedical staff, training their own doctors in every aspect of behavior, and the things are going to the part and parcel of the policies. With this, I really thank Dr. Srikanth and their team for inviting me to share my experiences in domain of medical law. I'm available for all my doctors anytime they need me. My video has got my email ID. Dr. Srikanth has got my email ID, my mobile numbers. You can anytime contact me. I am there for my doctors without any heads. Don't worry, I am going to pick your call. If it is emergency, you can give me 9-10 calls. I will understand that you are in trouble. Otherwise, my habit is to give a call back, because I respect my colleagues much and always see that my colleagues should not be in trouble, because they help a society a lot. They give a life to the people. And I know whatever happens is unintentional, not intentional. So I feel it is my responsibility to share my knowledge with my colleagues to protect them. So I really thanks all the delegates here who have heard me, are free to call me. Still, I'm available for the question answer, if at all anyone has got in their mind. So I over to you, Dr. Srikanth, for any other tip you want for your people or people. I'm there to help them with my knowledge. Thank you.
Thank you very much for incredible presentation on Doctors Risk Medical Legal Service. So thank you very much. I got a few doctors here with me. I'll ask if they have any questions. I'll pass on. Otherwise, I had received a few questions prior from all the registered delegates. So I'll just go to that one. So any questions, sir? Anything you got, sir, for sir?
It looks like practicing is frightening in the present and future scenario.
Yeah.
To what extent it recommends for us to cover insurance coverage?
Okay. What is the what should be the amount of coverage? Okay.
Reasonable amount.
Okay. Okay. Is it for a physician or a surgeon or what?
For a physician.
Okay. So the question is for a family physician. What is the right amount of coverage for a family physician, and what is the approximate premium for that?
See, family physician, if you talk about plain MBBS doctor, then the coverage I will definitely advise them to go for 50 lakhs minimum, and if you got a very good practice, then 1 crore. And if at all they are catering a patient for high society, then 2 crores. The premium is going to be around 500 rupees a month. That means around 6,000 rupees to 8,000 rupees. 6,000 could be for 50 lakhs. 8,000 could be for 1 crore. 10,000 could be for 2 crore. So it's a peanut amount for the MBBS doctor. If I talk about the family physician of MD medicine doctor, the consultant doctor, who admit the patient, become more riskier compared to the MBBS doctor who looks after OPD. For them, depend upon the catering of the patient. If we are catering high society people in metro cities, then they should have a coverage of not less than 2 crores. If they are having a normal practice, then 1 crore is suffice for them. And the premium for them is going to be around 8 to 10,000 maximum. That means 600 to 700 rupees a month. Not even 2 rupees a day. So they can take a policies which is not more than 8,000, 10,000. Add on to medical legal services, it is going to be 2,000-3,000 addition. Or if you just wanted to know about medical legal services, then it is 1,000 rupees a month. So 12,000 rupees a year. But if they take a combination with indemnity policies, then it become 50%. So they cover their indemnity policy in discount. So indemnity policy and medical legal services, both they can avail in 10 to 12,000 rupees.
Okay, thank you.
And for the surgeon, naturally, it is going to be 2,000 more. For any surgeon, orthopedic or could be 50 lakhs, it could be 12,000, 10,000 to 12,000. 1 crore, 15 to 16,000. 2 crore could be 22,000. For the plastic surgeon, anesthetic was the highest risk people. Definitely, instead of paying 36,000, which is in the market, they can pay 22,000 for 1 crore, 26,000 for 2 crores. The ranges between that only. If at all, having a hospital, you need to have an error omission policy, which covers your paramedical staffs, which covers all visiting consultant altogether, is going to be peanut amount. If you ask me roughly, for the hospital, smaller nursing home, which is of 25 bedded or 50 bedded, it may be 30 to 50,000 rupees, 30,000 odd in for 50 lakhs and 1 crore for 50,000. If it is a big hospital, the ranges are going to be in 60, 70,000, 80,000 lakh rupees. You can say whatever they are paying, they can look to their indemnity insurance. They will get less than around 40 to 50% discount what they are paying currently, and which is definitely can be seen if they have got a hospital policy with them. They can go today and check the premium they paid for their coverage. Surely with all benefit, they are going to get less than 20, 30% with the government insurance company.
Yeah, so there are many questions you already answered, sir. I just briefly touch upon a few things before I thank you for your time. If suppose I'm insured with Doctors Risk in 2021 and a mishap happens this year, normally comes to court in a few years' time, say 2024, will I be still covered by your company if I move on to a different...
We know this was a big question because there is two types of policy, claim-made policy and... policy, claim-made policy is a policy which is applicable when claim is made. For the purpose of the same, it is advisable to have a continuity of the policy. Secondly, whenever doctor wanted to switch over to any insurance company, it is advisable for them to take a retroactive date. Suppose today they are coming to Doctor's Risk. I'm giving example. And they have got continue policy of 10 years. And if they provide that policy, then we have got agreement with insurance company where they are going to put a retroactive date of 10 years back. So all the cases in past 10 years, maybe that doctor was covered by some other insurance company, will be taken care by this insurance company. So year of 2015 case, 2018 case, even if at all insurance company was not there where the doctor is, are going to take a liability of that cases also. So same applies to the people if they go with the cover you or any of the insurance company. It is vigilant doctor should ask them to put a retroactive date, which they will definitely not. Because with the 4,000, 5,000, you can't get the premium things. You can get just satisfaction that I have been protected, but when actual time will come, I can bet that they will not get a complaint. They cannot get a claim. Simple reason that the insurance company who gives the policy of 50 lakhs and 1 crore and take a responsibility of 50 lakhs and 1 crore in a smaller amount of 4,000 or 5,000, taking all the risk, I got all the ideas to repudiate the claim. When actual claim comes, I always say to my doctor, try it before you buy it. You will understand what you are buying. So just for saving 5,000 rupees a year, which is 400 rupees a month, which is not even 5 to 6 rupees a day, or 2 rupees a day less than your chai cutting or cigarette, you are putting you yourself in a greater risk. You need to rethink about that. So let me conclude with your question. The olden things, if it is in retroactive or continued policy, it is covered. It's a claim made policy. So the day it is claimed, means made, and policy, older policy was continued, it will be taken. If at all they take any other policy, switch over to any other company, ask them to take a retroactive date. So naturally, this insurance company, as they are taking responsibility, other company will take a responsibility, because this is IRDA ruling. It's not mine. It is a ruling of regulatory body. So my doctor should be vigilant while changing the insurance company. Even if they are coming to our company, they should demand that, or going to some other company, they should demand that, so that their continuity cannot be broken. So my doctor, who are having a 10-year-old policy and continuous, not to worry, they can jump in and their old things will be taken care of.
Okay, sir. So we are running short of time. I'll just the last question to submit. So many people say after retirement, you know, how long should a doctor take indemnity? Because it's argued that many cases have come in courts in India 10 years, 15 years after the incidents has happened. So what would be your suggestion?
Law of limitation says 2 years for filing any case in consumer fora. Law of limitation says 3 years in civil court. Our experience says 2 years delay is condoled. So 5 years is a time period which we advise after retirement doctor should continue. Even with less amount will do. Because when they were practicing, they are already covered for 50 lakhs and 1 crore. Now they are not practicing, they can take a coverage of 10 lakh and continue policy, or 5 lakh and continue the policy. Because if medical penny claim comes of that time insurance cover will be more important than the current insurance claim. That is an retroactive date. So they should continue for at least 5 years.
As per insurance, like driving, you can't drive after you're 90 years old. Is there an age limit that
There is no ruling on that. There is no terms condition which is fulfilled. Professional can practice. Ram Jethmalani has practiced till 94 years of his age as an advocate. So for professional, there is no age.
Okay, there's a question in the chat box. Which insurance company issues the personal indemnity policy? Which company is Dr. Mishra associated with?
I am associated with New India. But every company gives the policy. But we have chosen the best company in the country, best support system, or best claim settled company, and highest turnover company in India. We don't go with a private insurance company, because we know what is in a private. In private, it becomes really difficult because they've got lots of ideas to repeat the claim. And they know they have got their own legal team to fight. They know doctor is not going to go to the court of law, like a medical claim policy. They knowing that people are not going to go to court, 60% rejections are there. Out of that, 5 to 10% goes in court of law. They make them good. Remaining 50% is their profit of repudiation. So if they know the doctor is going to go to court of law and finally going to get settled in some amount, they are also doing business. So I advise that every government insurance company gives indemnity policy. You need to choose that which company you want. We have tied up with the government also. We have tied up with the private also. I have got a private insurance company whom I have tied up. I have got an insurance company with the government sector which I tied up. Both give the same coverage, both gives the best coverage, both have competitive rates. So, but we prefer more of government than the private per se.
So thank you, sir. Thank you very much for enlightening us. It was an amazing talk, and any leads I will, pass it over, and you can help us as you're helping us for the last 16 years. Thank you very much for your time. So
thank you, Dr. Shikant. Thank you all the delegates here. Thank you very much.